Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Kennedy School. I'm Nick Burge, professor here at the Kennedy School. I want to introduce my good friend, Ambassador Cameron Munter, who is the American ambassador to Pakistan. He's going to speak about U.S.-Pakistan relations. Following his talk, he's going to take questions from students and fellows and invited guests, and he and I look forward to that. I think a lot of you know, you've not only Googled Ambassador Munter, if you're an enterprising student, you know that he's a career American diplomat. You know that he's served our country for well over 25 years in various parts of the world. He really made his mark in the 1990s as one of our team promoting the expansion of NATO. For a long time served in Eastern Europe at an exciting time, a revolutionary time, when communism and fell in that part of the world. He served twice in Iraq, he's been in Afghanistan. He has been in war zones continuously since 2005, and he is now our ambassador to Pakistan, which I think arguably is the most challenging American diplomatic position in the world. All of you read the headlines, a lot of you know a lot about Pakistan, a lot of you know a lot about the United States. It is a vital relationship for both countries. And from an American perspective, there is no more important country in the world for our vital interest in Pakistan. And yet there's also no more complicated relationship with any country in the world. And Cameron, Ambassador Munter, has been in the thick of it, in the middle of it. I guess he'll tell us what it was like to be there when Osama bin Laden the operation was launched against Osama bin Laden last May 1st. I'm sure he'll tell us what it's like to work with the Pakistani government on big issues like counterterrorism and the war in Afghanistan, and whether or not it's going to be possible to negotiate an end to the war through a reconciliation process. And I know that Ambassador Munter has a lot of thoughts on the India-Pakistan relationship as well. So he's at the heart of American diplomacy on, I think, the most important issue of our time, and that's war and peace in South Asia. So we're really delighted that he's chosen to be here at the Kennedy School. He is meeting with some students individually. He'll be meeting with a group of students tomorrow morning for breakfast, and he's meeting with faculty members and our fellows. So it's a good opportunity for us at the Kennedy School to have Ambassador Munter here for a day and a half. So without further ado, let me ask Ambassador Munter to speak to you, and then we'll have a good discussion for that. Thanks.
Former academic. So we have till full record time,
yeah? Yeah, 8 to 5 minutes.
Great. Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much, Nick, and thank all of you for being here today. What I'd like to do is have a fairly informal conversation with you about U.S.-Pakistan relations. And leave plenty of time for questions, because you know, that's how we're going to figure out some of the issues that we're dealing with and have a good talk. I am a former academic, and you know the rule: those who can do, those who can't teach, and those who can't teach become diplomats. So I was an historian, and I learned very quickly that there's no future in the past. And so I left UCLA, where I was teaching, and joined the Foreign Service, went to Europe, as Nick said, for a number of years, and then realized that was over once they got in the European Union. And since that time, we've gone to places that have nothing but trouble, like Serbia and Iraq, this type of place. But by far the most challenging job I've ever had is my current job. I've been in Pakistan since late 2010. It seems that as soon as I arrived, a series of disasters came, and we don't want to look for causality there. But the fact is that there has been it's been a very, very tough year, 2011. And what I want to talk to you about is the legacy of that year, what maybe led up to that, what we're going to do in policy to try to adjust to what has happened for the last year, and what we can foresee in the future, both in Pakistan but also regionally. As all of you know, in 2008, there was kind of an upward swing in American interest and commitment to Pakistan that coincided with the return of democracy after the Musharraf years. What you had was people like Joe Biden, John Kerry, Dick Lugar, pushing through the Senate a new bill, because as you know, the way that we demonstrate our love for countries in the United States is to have money for them. But all cynicism aside, there was a wave of, I think, idealism. Now that there was going to be a return to civilian rule, there was going to be the opportunity to give the commitment that we had not given in the 1990s. The Pakistani narrative of betrayal from the United States, the kind of ups and downs of the relationships that focused most bluntly on the Pressler Amendment of 1990, is something that American policymakers took very seriously and said, okay, 1990, we walked away, we're not going to do that anymore. So there was an enormous effort not only to put together an aid package, but to try to put together an approach that would allow a relationship with Pakistan that would be more fruitful. This really was embodied by Richard Holbrooke and his when he took over, his role as the kind of grand marshal of all things in this part of the world that ended up being an AFPAC policy. Richard Holbrooke is probably the reason I took this job, because whatever those of you who know Richard Holbrooke, he drove me crazy. But I miss him every day, because he was a great man and a really committed diplomat. What happened during that time was that we overpromised. I can say that. Holbrooke can't fight back. Right? We overpromised, not because we meant to overpromise, but because there was so much of an effort to try to build through the strategic partnership that we developed, an all-encompassing relationship which would affect everything from water to the role of women in Pakistani life, to energy, to defense and security, to communications. We had a very exhausting and exhaustive set of policies focusing on state-to-state relations, but trying to get below that level to social relations. It reached its culmination really in a series of meetings in October of 2010, when all of these working groups came together in Washington, big plenary sessions, etc. And where, coincidentally, General Kiani handed across the table to President Obama a document that we also call Kiani 3.0, which was Kiani's assessment of what the Pakistanis wanted in Afghanistan. I'll touch on that in a little bit. What had happened, though, in those years between 2008 2009, the return of democracy, the election of Zardari, the government, etc., was that American policy began to struggle with the distinctions or even the contradictions of its long-term goals and its short-term goals. And by that I mean that we had a commitment to the long-term stability of Pakistan, as evidenced through our assistance program, through our military-to-military program, our training that we were doing, building up the intel relationship. And that was defined as being a tandem, kind of a parallel process to the efforts we were making in Afghanistan, and indeed to the hope that Pakistani-Indian relationships would get better as well. The short term tended to be more focused on counterterrorism. And there's a certain D word that I'm not allowed to use in public, but there were these explosions take place in the tribal areas of Pakistan. And this was just one of the elements of our effort to further our goals to wipe out al-Qaeda in the Pakistani areas, to work against the safe havens that were such a threat to our forces in Afghanistan, and to work to try to end the terror, actually, that a number of the groups in Pakistan, the militant groups, had visited on the people there. What happened is that these long-term and these short-term goals crashed a bit in 2011. From the Raymond Davis case, when an American contractor was picked up after a self-defense shooting in Lahore, spent 7 weeks in jail, and gave me a crash course in learning Sharia law so we could get him out, to the strike that took place on March 16th, killed almost 50 people in the Fatah, to the raid in Abbottabad, some Biden was killed, to the comments that were made by Admiral Mullen in front of the Senate Armed Services Committee that equated the Haqqani network as an arm of the ISI, and finally to the incident, the tragic incident that took place in Walmart on November 26th. At 2 month intervals, almost precisely 2 month intervals, January, March, and September, we had something that knocked us down in our relationship. And I would posit that this was in part because we were trying so hard to reach our counterterrorism goals that we, in part, did damage to our own long-term goals in the country. Now, when you're looking to blame people, it's very important to see that in this relationship, neither side is blameless. And Pakistan also didn't cover itself with glory in various ways during this time. But the fact is that what we had hoped for, which was to have the relationship take off between 2008 and the present, crashed in 2011. And after the Mulmand incident, it kind of fell over, and we're still getting up from that one. The Pakistani parliament will be debating U.S.-Pakistani ties, we think, maybe next week, maybe the week after. They've been promising that they would do this since December. This is a long-term process whereby the Pakistanis are going to reassess what it is that they can do with us and what they can't do with us. Now, how did we get to this trust deficit, which is the phrase that they use very often? We got to it because we had relationships that I think were based primarily on state-state relationships and perhaps not strong enough on society-society relationships. For those of you who have read Anatole Levin's book, Pakistan, a Hard Country, you'll know that the essential message that he gives, the best I've seen, is a message that you have a country that has a fundamentally weak state apparatus. A weak state meaning that the ability of the state to deal with social issues, social welfare issues, is limited. And a very strong society, not a civil society in the Western sense, but a strong collection of loyalties, tribal loyalties, family loyalties, provincial loyalties, ethnic differences, that makes the country into, in many ways, a ship that sometimes can't go forward, can't go backwards, but somehow can't sink. A resilient structure that can take a pounding, but is aware that in terms of a secular trend, it's falling behind other countries that it sees in the region, that are able to break out of this stable structure because for whatever reason they have a more harmonious relationship between their state and their social structures. What's happened now is that there's, one very senior member of the Pakistan military said to us, he said, you think you have a problem of trust deficit with Pakistan? Look at the trust deficit between the Pakistan government and the Pakistan people. That's where the real trust deficit is. So part of the problem that I'm talking about is that we're dealing with American good intentions, American, perhaps, logic that was internally sometimes inconsistent, but with a society that doesn't always lend itself to those kind of developmental tasks or political tasks because of its own internal problems. Since that time, I'd like to talk about, since the time of this crash, I'd like to see where we are kind of now in three key areas in dealing with state-to-state relations. In the intelligence field, the Raymond Davis case was basically a disaster that made us freeze our intelligence, our cooperation. And the Abbottabad raid didn't help it much either. But since that time, we've actually repaired much of the relationship. And I would say the ISI-CIA relationship now is still cooperative. It has come back to being cooperative. And I think the reason for this is that the Pakistani authorities, despite whatever you might read in The Nation or other fine journals in Pakistan, the Pakistani government does realize that it has a lot in common with the United States on counterterrorism. We do joint targeting. We share information. We meet frequently. And despite what you may have heard, we have still a decent relationship between our intel services. This may change in the near future. General Pasha is widely believed to be leaving his job on March 18th. If that happens, no matter who comes in, and it would probably be from the senior corps commanders, one of the candidates that come in, it will change the relationship, which, as you know, those of you who know Pakistan well, know that it's all about personalities, and the personality of Pasha, with all of his strengths and his weaknesses, is a personality we know well, and we work with very closely. We'll have someone new in power, and we'll have to get used to this person precisely at a time when we're trying to redefine the relationship, improve the relationship between the two countries. The second category would be the military-to-military relationship. that one has really taken the lead. At the beginning of 2011, we had 150 special operations forces in the FATA training a number of the Pakistani Frontier Corps and 11th Corps, the people all the way from Deer all the way down through the FATA in the Northwest. And as a result of the Abbottabad raid, they were all dismissed, basically told by General Kiani to leave. I think that partly this was Kiani's effort to show, Kiani is identified as, you know, General Kiani is identified as a fairly pro-American soldier, and he had to do this, he believed, to show his independence from us. We made it clear that the way our Congress gives assistance is that when we get trainers, we also give equipment. And when the trainers go, the equipment has to go too. So what we said is, we understand that you're angry about Abbottabad. The point of Abbottabad was not to humiliate. The point of Abbottabad was to kill someone who was a common enemy of ours. And he said, yes, you still have to leave. And we said, if you get rid of the boys, you get rid of the toys. And he said, yes, that's right. We said to him, if you do that, if you get rid of the night vision goggles, if you get rid of the computers, if you get rid of the sniper rifles, your guys are going to die. He said, I understand. So he's quite aware of what the impact of this is in the fight against the militants. He made the decision anyway, and felt he had to. So our military presence in the country has shrunk dramatically, and it has stayed shrunk. And our cooperation between the Pakistan military and the American military has become much less. Intel fusion cells, which are these joint intelligence offices near the border, have been closed. And it's probably not too much to say that the Lomon incident might not have happened quite the way it happened had this withdrawal not taken place. So it's very tragic that this happened. There's a very important point to make about the Pakistan military, that even though our relations are right now cool, I guess I would say, there are changes going on in that military. There's a lot of people who tend to think of the military as a fairly solid and fairly unified institution. And I think it's important to make a distinction between a horizontal and a vertical axis. That the horizontal axis is a demography change that's taking place. Most of the people in the Pakistan military above the 2 or 3 star rank are people who were educated, at least partly, in the United States. Kayani, for example, went to Fort Leavenworth. He was a classmate of the current chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Dempsey. And those personal links and those personal tendencies are pronounced in the very same ranks. The level below that, and this is where this horizontal break takes place, the people who are at the 1 star rank, maybe colonels, are what we would call the lost generation, the people who were cut off from American training during the years of the Chrysler era, from 1990 until 2001. Many of them don't know us well. Many of them are what we also would call the children of Zia, people who came of age in their officer careers during a time of a greater attention to Islam in the life of the country in Pakistan. So that we are likely, in a generation coming into the Pakistan Army, to see people who are going to be less familiar, I think it's fair to say, with American traditions and have fewer American contacts than what we're used to. I would dispute that that means that we're seeing the Islamicization of the military. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying, though, that there are people who may have different or at least less familiar characteristics in years to come. Secondly, there's this vertical split that I wanted to mention, which is those people who have served in the Northwest, those people who have served often with American trainers, those people who have taken on the militants. And as you know, they've suffered many more casualties than all of our troops have. All of the ISAF troops in Afghanistan. The Pakistani sacrifices, I think, 4,000 troops, where we haven't come anywhere near that. So that, and maybe estimates between 30 and 40,000 civilians. This is a serious war. Any other country that could be called a civil war. But the Pakistanis, resilient people, they're fighting this war, and many of us don't even think of that war. That causes a fair amount of resentment in Pakistan. And I think we would be wise to remember what it is that they've lost. Now, in this group, you have people who have fought the counterinsurgency, and then you have the traditional eastern cantonments and eastern bases that are on the Indian border, where you have people training in a more traditional way for kind of holding gap, tank battles that they have trained for, looking at India as the primary foe. And I think that what we're seeing is not a split, but at least a certain distinction, certain tension in within the military, between those people in the Pakistani military who realize, as we believe is the case, that the primary threat to Pakistan's stability are the militants, rather than India, which is, of course, the traditional doctrine that Pakistan has had, that, that the existential threat to Pakistan would be an Indian invasion. I think now what you find is, you find between people who have these different experiences, some distinction in the army between this, between who is threatening Pakistan. One of the ways this comes out is that in the opening towards India, which has been taking place over the last couple of years, it's not a pronounced movement in spite of the army, as many people have thought in the past, that somehow the army was committed to anti-Indian thoughts. In fact, there are many who think that the army is coming around now to an understanding that the big threat comes from the West, and that a rapprochement with India is possible. I don't want to be too optimistic about that, but I think one of the unusual second-order effects of the war in the West is to reorient, in a sense, the way for many years the Pakistani military has thought about its threat. So I've talked about intel, which I think is doing okay. I've talked about military-to-military relationships, which I don't think are doing okay and I would like to see improved. And then third, in assistance and economic issues, you know, we've had the emotional response to the events of last year. The best example I can think of is for just how it's affected our assistance. The Chief Minister of Punjab, Shahbaz Sharif, has said he wants to break the beggar's bowl. He unfortunately said it in public, and so the U.S. Congress heard. And the U.S. Congress does not like to give money to people who don't want our money. So sadly, we have decided to cut off assistance to Punjab. And we are now using our assistance money elsewhere. It's a shame. I think that what we need to do is continue to work in key areas. Our top priority is energy, just behind that, education, health, and stabilization programs. And that has become somewhat of a political football. Now, over time, what we need to do, I believe, more prescriptively, is that we have to be able to say to Pakistan, if we want to change the relationship, that assistance to Pakistan should have the goal of ending assistance to Pakistan. We've never done that before. And Pakistanis, in many cases, believe that we have assistance in order to keep Pakistani on assistance, in order to have leverage. I think it's important that we recognize that with the difficulties that we've had, the only way for us to get past a relationship that's fraught with the kind of anger and misunderstanding that we've had is to try to create a partnership. And to create a partnership, you have to get away as much as you can from an assistance relationship. So what we're hoping to do, with the Pakistanis in partnership, is to define assistance that has as the end goal getting Pakistan past assistance and building, once again, this relationship with a stronger society that will involve much more business, investment, trade, and much less assistance. That is to define the relationship as one in which the respect that the Pakistanis believe they're not getting is one that's given to them. And I would add, going even farther than just in assistance, we can do that institutionally by working with those progressive forces in Pakistan, such as the media. The media is very uneven in Pakistan, but there are some very, very courageous and some very innovative members of the media who want to see progressive change there. We should work more with business. Business is leading the charge for the opening towards India. And I think over time, it's coming around to understand that there needs to change in the kind of stultified, as some would say, feudal system in India. And institutions like universities, we need to work more at a level, a social level, and less at a state level. In a funny way, a problem that I'm going back to is in my memories of the good old days in Poland in 1987. Where, yeah, we dealt with the authorities, but the real work we did was with the people, with the church, with the labor unions, with the institutions Because what's happened to us now in Pakistan is we've become identified with many of the things that are wrong in Pakistan that aren't our fault. If there's bad governance, I defy the Pakistanis to say that we caused the bad governance. Our assistance programs are not crooked. We may not get it done, but we get done. But when we catch someone, you know, stealing money, we close that program down. And, you know, contrary to what people think, we don't melt the gold down into ingots and send it off to someone's bank account and buy. We really do try to be straightforward. And what we ought to be associated with is transparency, accountability, the things that we stand for, the thing this money is being spent for, and the things that, in the general sense, we want to see in this country. Right now, what we're associated with is that we've tolerated coups, that we've turned our back on Pakistan, or for whatever reason, whether we think that the Pressler Amendment was right or not. The Pakistani narrative is that we turn our back on Pakistan, and that we somehow support those people who are not living up to those standards. We're very unpopular in Pakistan. Probably 6-10% of the people have a positive image of America. But unlike other countries who don't care what America thinks, Pakistanis in public opinion polls care desperately what America thinks. They want very much. They'll say in one sense, this is America is doing bad things in Pakistan, but they want desperately for America to do good things in Pakistan. I have never been treated with anything but the greatest respect by anyone who I've met in Pakistan. And that includes Jamaat Islami, all of the people who are sometimes vilified in this country as being just totally irreconcilable people. Most people in Pakistan, I believe, want to see us live up to their image. What we can do this for, what they think we want to do. This is where I'm most optimistic about the future. If we're able to get through the issues of the immediate future, Afghanistan, the war on terror, the change in the relations between the governments, I think in the long run there is a very fundamental affinity between what Pakistanis want and what Americans want. That brings me to my last question we have here, which is the question of kind of diplomacy in the region. In Afghanistan, as I mentioned, I think that the eventual withdrawal of troops, the end of the combat mission of the withdrawal of troops, will probably take away some of the tension in the relationship. But it's going to need to be replaced by another commitment to Afghanistan, which I think you're going to see when the president has the NATO summit and the joint summit in Chicago in May, where you talk about the commitment that the countries who want to see a democratic and stable Afghanistan make. If we can do that, I think that much of the tension which has been caused by the long-term, short-term problems that we have in the relationship will come out of the relationship, and we can commit to working together on regional issues. I don't think that's an impossibility, but I think right now it's very fraught. Indeed, I think one of the problems we have is that there is an academic habit, an academic discipline of talking of inward-looking debate about the bilateral relationship. It's very sterile. It tends to be 90-year-old retired generals being paid for by people like Harvard University to come over here and talk with 90-year-old Americans to talk about all the things that are wrong with the relationship and to repeat many of these narratives that I've talked to you about. I've made a new rule that when we start doing this, these kinds of meetings, I don't want anybody from Delhi, or I'm sorry, from Islamabad, I don't want anybody who's from the government, and I don't want anybody who's over 40, and I don't want anybody who's male. The idea is we have a habit of paying money to repeat into kind of settle old ideas about the bilateral relationship. If we are going to be successful in the relationship with Pakistan, I think we're going to have to get away from the bilateral talk, and we're going to have to regionalize the discussion. The opening to India is a very positive thing. That's what Delhi cracked in my mind. We are supporting that. We're doing it quietly. We're doing it because this is a Pakistani Indian lead. Their links with India are very gradually moving ahead in track two areas, commerce and business, even in the judicial area of working together to try to solve the issues such as the Mumbai attack. If we're able to define our relationship away from, does America love Pakistan? Does Pakistan love America? And if we're able to define the relationship as, what do we care about? Water? You're not going to solve water without the impact. What do you care about? Energy? You're not going to solve energy without Central Asia. You're not going to solve energy without India. You're not going to solve your economic and your investment issues without China. If we're able to regionalize these issues in the way we talk about them, I think it will pull us away from what I think has become a fairly, as I mentioned, sterile, even destructive obsession about bilateral issues that we go through in our discussion. And I think that the long-term prospects for that are pretty good. Once we have hopefully successfully come to the end of the Afghan war, and as we see that the problems that the countries in the region face are fairly similar, I think America can take part in a kind of discussion that my colleague Mark Grossman, the senior representative for Afghanistan and Pakistan, is pushing with various names like the, it used to be called the New Silk Road one. That's not the joint part of it, but we have some other name. But the idea is regional cooperation based on education, based on trade, based on the kinds of issues that the region needs. If we're going to get out of what has been a very tough period, it's going to be because both countries decide that they're going to look at something bigger than just themselves. The last and final point I want to make is that this is going to be perhaps a more modest relationship. And I hope modest in both senses of the word. Modest in the sense of the word that it's going to be smaller, but modest that it's going to be something where there's a little less bluster, I hope, on both sides, where we talk a little bit, we beat our breasts a little bit less, and talk about those concrete things that we can do together as we're trying to build a relationship with others in the region. We call this the Turner Doctrine. I don't know if you study the Turner Doctrine. This is from the American philosopher Tina Turner. Said, what's love got to do with it? What we're trying to do now is we're trying to figure out how do we take out, sadly, I mean, a lot of the emotion that's been in the relation. What we have to do is we have to work now, I think, on being very realistic, sometimes being very tough. You know, we can't give money to everybody. Maybe we shouldn't give money to everybody. Maybe we have to think hard about choices of a relationship that isn't going to be everything to everyone. I think that's the healthiest thing we can do for ourselves and the healthiest thing we can do for Pakistan. And so with that, I'd like to take some questions.
Okay, everyone. Ambassador Munter is here for South Asia Week. So last Thursday, we had Jay Khan, a member of the Indian Parliament. We have Ambassador Munter here. We have Zalmay Khalilzad, who's going to be here giving a talk on Thursday afternoon about his time in Afghanistan and Iraq. We're going to focus with him on the Afghan war and how it might end. And we have Vera Palmer Rao, the Indian Ambassador of the United States, who'll be with us on Friday morning. We have a final visitor for South Asia Week. It's Ambassador Sham Sarn, who's the former, Brian, just take it off. The former Foreign Secretary of India, Sham Sarn. Cameron, as you can see, I'm not betraying any confidences. I think he might be over 40. He is male. He is from New Delhi. But I think he's the smartest foreign policy voice in India today.
So maybe he has to start off.
I think you should give him a chance.
Okay.
And Ambassador Sarn is speaking here at Harvard on Wednesday afternoon. So consult our website if you want to see any of these speakers. But we thought we'd have a very intensive look at the problems of this region and the opportunities for the United States. And this is brought to you by our Future Diplomacy Project, which seeks to bring diplomats here to talk about real world issues. So, Sean, thank you for being with us. That was a thoughtful, thought provoking, and even provocative speech. I'd like to ask the first question. Here's the first question, Cameron. As I understand it, about a year ago, when Secretary Clinton gave a speech at Georgetown, I believe it was January 18th, 2011, she indicated that the United States was changing course in Afghanistan. She didn't say this, but as I understand it, the thought is that there is no conventional victory possible for the coalition forces. United States, the Afghan government, the Pakistani government, the Indian government, and others might look for an opportunity to build a road towards negotiations and a peace agreement. Part of that involves reconciliation between the Taliban and the Afghan government, and the Taliban and the United States government, and others. From your perspective, Islamabad, from the Pakistani government perspective, as you mentioned it, is such an outcome possible? Is this war going to end at the negotiating table, the way most wars end? Or shall it be protracted, endless violence for years to come? Obviously, most all of us would want. What's your thought on this?
The answer is yes. I think that from the Pakistani point of view, the response was what took you so long. When the Secretary gave a speech, I believe this was the Asia Society speech. She talked about the need to put diplomacy ahead of military, not to end the military, but to put diplomacy ahead. That is, those things we do must serve a diplomatic function or a diplomatic result, rather than diplomacy serving as the echo or the follow-on to a military result. So I think your assessment is fair, that people realize, and not only just people in the street, but General Petraeus and others have said, a purely military solution is not the answer. Now the question is, how do you get the proper diplomatic solution? And there we do have some differences with the Pakistanis that we try to work out. We had a mechanism that was created after this speech, which is called the trilateral mechanism. We like these kinds of words. There's a group called the tripartite group, which is the Pakistani, Afghan, and American military soldiers who just started to meet again for the first time a week ago at Tolkien Gate. That's tripartite. When you're tripartite, that's military. The trilateral is diplomatic. And this is a Pakistani, Afghan, American effort to try to work together to define those ways in which all sides can support an Afghan-led solution to the fighting there. And by Afghan-led, it's important that the way all sides, I believe, are defining it, and we're doing this in common, is that it's a conversation between Afghans, among Afghans. That is, if Pakistan can help, Pakistan helps. If America can help, America helps. But it's supposed to be an internal Afghan discussion. So the question, is Pakistan at the table? Are Pakistan's views going to be represented? We're all there to help the Afghans. It's not that there's a carving up of any sort that's taking place. Now, the difference has been around the doctrine, the statement that the Secretary of State came up with was quite talk-built. And the American position on this is that we are going to make sure that we continue to take advantage of the military advances that we've had in Afghanistan while we reach out both in the area of reconciliation, which is defined as basically having the internal political discussions, and the reintegration process, which is a term of art for those people who would be taken from the battlefield, the people who are foot soldiers who would be reintegrated into Pakistani society. And that process is ongoing. Sadly, the problems that we have, the series of every 2 month problems that I mentioned to you, have gotten in the way of this trilateral function and in the way of our ability to work together. So that even though I think we share the same goals, I'd be kidding you if I said that we're deeply in conversation simply because it's been interrupted so many times by the problems we've had this last year. So it's a good illustration of a way that America, Pakistan, and Afghanistan can work together, but that the problems we had have gotten in the way. So that trilateral group has not met for months. We hope it will.
Yeah. And the negotiations on the American side are being led by Ambassador Mark Grossman, who until his appointment was a fellow in our future diplomacy project here at Harvard. So that we recommend it to you for that reason, Cameron. Who would like to ask the first question? And if I could just ask, if you would just identify yourself, if you're a student, what's your name, what you're studying here, if you're a fellow, et cetera, if you're an outsider, just let us know that too. Yes, sir. And there are microphones here in the center of the room. Well, I can actually give you this microphone.
My question is about the carrier.
My name is Zahir Ali. I'm outsider. President of the United States for the last 41 years and born in Pakistan. I've got one comment and two questions. It'll be a very short comment, but basically, first of all, I'm impressed with your dynamism because I was watching you about a few hours ago at BBC. And I'm going to go into that, Karachi, and that is the lead to my question. To answer one of the things which you said, the Pakistanis like us and don't like us, I think Pakistanis has never overcome the fact that when Jinnah, the founder of Pakistan, interrupted his speech at the creation of Pakistan, interrupted his speech and said, the General David Eisenhower is the first president of the United States who has recognized Pakistan as a country. Pakistan has never overcome that. Okay? Now, coming back to that.
Overcome it or forgot it? It's a positive
thing. No, I mean, it's very positive.
Yeah.
It was a very positive thing. And the history is basically that night, Liaquat Ali Khan flew over to the United States and the relationship started. Okay, Pakistan has never overcome that. Second
is leading to the question.
Second, the question. Okay. That was a comment. Okay, yeah. The question. The question being that I think that we Americans and Pakistanis both, and I'm both, we beat our chest. For example, the issue of Balochistan being discussed in United States Senate, followed by your comments in Karachi interview day before, but a few hours ago, that Balochistan has got an HR issue, followed by last night, which was daytime in Pakistan, a unanimous resolution to call ambassador as a demarch, that why he has made that comments. Okay, so.
What's the question?
The question basically is the why we do that. Why suddenly Balochistan has become an issue in the area of already troubled issues between Pakistan and the United States?
Yeah, it's a very tough issue, and you're absolutely right that it's a sensitive one. In my career, in places like Serbia, places like communist Poland and the Eastern Bloc, we have never shied away, even with friends, we never shy away from talking about human rights. It's something that makes us, as American diplomats, perhaps unique, although I don't think it's unique with many others and other countries that follow this. But this is a tenet of our policy around the world. It's not unique to Pakistan. And when we say that we want to cast a light on the murder of journalists, on the disappearance of people who profess to be for autonomy or even for to point out problems in Pakistan. The point here is we are not trying to humiliate anyone. We're trying to tell the truth. And we think that a truthful relationship with Pakistan is a more constructive one than one where we wink and nod. I mean, one of the things that in the past Pakistanis accuse us of is that we have not been clear. I think the way to be, to show respect to a country, the way to have a dialogue which is open is to say, look, if people disappear in the middle of the night, we don't know why they're disappearing, but it's definitely a problem. We say this constructively, and we say this not with the agenda that we want to see some accusations of separatism or things like that. That's not what we mean. But we like to think that we say this in the way that we're raising, as we would in any country, key human rights issues that are important for us to bring to the attention of the public. You're right that what we need to work on is the way we do this. And I certainly hope that the way I did it on TV in Pakistan was not offensive, but if that's what the Pakistani authorities say that they're going to ask for in public meeting, I still have work to do.
Yes, sir. Yes, it's working.
Hi. My name is Banu. I'm a graduate student here. My question is, can you tell us more about Pakistan's relationship with China and its implications for Pakistan's relationship with both India and the United States?
I think Pakistan has a very healthy relationship with China. China is very quiet, doesn't do a lot of this. You know? China does not give much assistance to Pakistan. China is a very invested in projects which are on a business basis, and those are very positive things for China. I think that Pakistan and China have a very constructive relationship. My relationship with the Chinese ambassador is very warm and friendly, and I think Pakistan's lucky to have such good friends as the United States and China. So I think that's a very positive thing. What's very interesting, though, is the potential for the opening to India, because I hope that in that region, you know, there's a lot of variable geometry here. There's a lot of calculations from a lot of the countries in the region about who gets geostrategic advantage of things of this sort. What I meant to say at the end of my presentation, that if we look at things in a regional context, this context should include Pakistan's relationship to India, to China, perhaps to us and others, as something that we see in the context of long-term growth, environmental issues, other kinds of problems that we hope it will be seen in a fairly constructive way, not as a competition. I think the jury's out. We'll see if that can develop, but that's something we really want to see.
Yes, right up here.
I can talk now. Okay. I understand I'm working on a mid-career. As the relationship with Pakistan has started to deteriorate, was it specific types of diplomacy that were failing, or all types? Because it seemed like there was a pretty quick downward spiral. So I'm just wondering why it happened so quickly and why it wasn't prepared very quickly, and I mean, it just hit bottom.
Yeah, you know, if we had any kind of diplomats out there, we could fix this. it's a tough question, and for me, a very personal one. I don't know why it collapsed as quickly as it did. I can only say that the way I explain it is that there were a lot of dashed hopes. We had made expectations very high, and I think on the Pakistani side there was an expectation that things were going to be. A lot of problems that had been long-term problems were going to be solved immediately. And instead, they went the other direction, and this kind of fed on some huge feelings of disappointment. I don't have a good answer for you why it happened so quickly, why it wasn't something you could arrest. I can say, though, that it did have a lot to do with the way we had overbuilt from 2008, and perhaps the fact that that it's always very difficult to be fighting immediate war, counter-terrorist war, and to have long-term developmental goals and to see them crash into it. I wish I had a better answer.
Bali.
Yeah. Hi, Bali from Islamia. I'm from Karachi, Pakistan. I just wanted to first of all thank you on two things. Firstly, the unprecedented ambassadorship that you are showing in Pakistan, what you and your wife have been very forthcoming in public, and I think most Pakistanis appreciate that openness. Secondly, thanks for mentioning the 30,000 to 40,000 civilians killed and 5,000 troops, which is a 9/11 happening every year since 9/11. Having said that, I'm quite disappointed that in your address, you did mention a lot about military aid and economic aid, but didn't mention enough about helping and promoting democracy within Pakistan. By the same token, since I'm allowed to use the D word, I will go ahead and use it, the drone attacks. That's something which, as you know, the elected government of Pakistan and the parliament has passed multiple resolutions. And your government's disregard to kind of resolve that issue, and it probably is effective, nobody's denying that perhaps, but to resolve that issue by dialogue, and like you're not even allowed to mention to them. So that's like a little bit of a little bit disappointing to hear. So I would appreciate if you can just comment on that.
Yeah, I'm starting with the second first. There is dialogue. We did talk to the Pakistanis about this. And as you know from other things that you know in public, that we really want to figure out a way, since we share the goal of fighting terrorism, and we really want to figure out a way to fight terrorism where each fights in the best way we can. So we do try, and it's an incomplete story, and I hear what you say about Pakistani consent. The first thing you had mentioned, this question is
democracy.
Let me be clear about assistance. We give about 50% of our assistance is military, and 50% of our assistance is civilian under the care of the government. That is, we give about $1 billion a year in each category, which is a lot of money. You know, that's a lot of dough. So the point is, we are committed to spending money out of that $1 billion that's in care of the government area to not only questions of energy, but human rights issues, social issues, social justice. We train lady health workers so that women who don't have access to health care are able to get it. We have all kinds of democratic training for all parties who are democratic in the country. In other words, it does exist. We do have it. And I don't know, maybe we should do a better job of publicizing that. I would like to think that this is an example of the kind of thing that with a maturing relationship, it would be less assistance, more kind of partnership. I'd like to see, for example, clever students from Harvard going over to work with clever students from the Karyazom University on political change. I mean, I'd like to change the kind of assistance we give to partnership if we could. But we are working, we're spending a lot of money, if that's one way of measuring it, on democratization and on governance. And we want to make sure that as we support the free media, that we're, even though sometimes the media in Pakistan can be exasperating, nonetheless, it's dynamic, and it is really a force to be reckoned with. So we are trying to support it, and what I'm hearing from you is maybe we can do a better job of explaining how we do it.
Here.
Thank you for being here. I'm Piyush Rasha, and I'm a this year. I have two short questions. One is, you said that you will be working on more social relations with the society. My understanding is that the basic area in Pakistan, which is the most affected by this violence and militancy, are the tribal areas and the tribal farms. But how much maneuver do you have there to work? Like, I was reading some news reports that the American diplomats can't even travel to Peshawar if they don't have a no objection certificate. And the second question related to that one is, what's the status of reconstruction opportunity zones? Yeah, I think that long ago, and we don't hear much about that.
The reconstruction opportunity zones were something promised by President Bush in 2005. They were going to be helping opportunities for construction and work for industry to grow, especially in the Fatah and that region. We have not been able to get that legislation through Congress, and there's no excuse for that. It's a failure on our part. We have to keep trying, and frankly, it's not easy because of the current atmosphere in Washington. It's not likely we can get it through. So, pure and simple, we have to say that's a failure on our part because we intended to do it. We believe that helping Pakistani production and access to American markets is a great way to help Pakistan move ahead without aid. And that, plus we hope to have a bilateral investment treaty and other elements of market access, would be a really strong way to move. And there is a consensus in Pakistan that we ought to do that. And I think there's a consensus among friends of Pakistan in this country that we ought to do that. And we have our work cut out for us. Because the events of the last year not only hurt the American image in Pakistan, it walloped the Pakistani image in America. So this is not going to be easy. On the question of, and remind me again, I have to see
this. Is the whole
travel to Peshawar. It's true that diplomats are not, it's not easy to travel in the Fatah for us. We have a number of partners. What we try to do in that part of the country is work with partners to achieve our goals. Let's say, for example, one of our successful projects is building roads through the Fatah to open up areas that were previously inaccessible to people so that they can have not only the access to the settled Pakistan, but also access to Afghanistan. And make it, just tie the people who live there to the rest of the world. Those are done through repaid or frontier works. That is to say, we, General Kiani is Army Corps of Engineers. So we pay them to build the road, and we get the, that effect. It doesn't mean the Americans are there doing the work, but the work does get done. So that's that kind of method is how we work in that part of the country, through people who can work there, even though it's very difficult. And we want to continue.
Hi, I'm Dr. Simon Pedros. I work affiliated with the Harvard Medical School. I have a question since you mentioned that Chief Minister of Punjab Basri was not very optimistic about the aid. So in coming election, it's most likely it's possible that either him, his party or non-Khan probably maybe they're in a better position to win the elections. So how do you foresee US relationship with Pakistan like in, after the next elections?
Yeah, good point. I think that it's very possible that because of the events that have taken place over the last year, that criticism of the United States could be seen as a look-at, right? I speak frequently with Imran Khan. I think Imran Khan represents for many people kind of a voice of change, and yet he doesn't hold back. He's critical of those things that you can talk about that I can't talk about. He's straightforward and I think articulates what a lot of people in that country are thinking. I believe, however, that my contact with Shabazz Sharif, my contact with Nawaz, and also with Imran Khan and a host of other people, is that deep down, what they don't want is to see the Americans go away. What they want to see is a relationship with the United States where they feel that there's a partnership, where there's a better sense of respect, and I feel, personally, that the way to do that is to expand, to get them, if I have to be prescriptive, out of a certain narrative that they have created about the United States. We need to be a little bit, perhaps, less arrogant. And it seemed that way about Balochistan, I'm sorry, didn't mean to be. They, I think, have to break out of some, I think, unhealthy narratives about the way people act. So that we come beyond that and build, I hope, in a regional context, a better relationship. So I expect that there may be some fireworks in the election, but I'm optimistic in the long run. I think we can figure out a way to do it.
Sorry. Ambassador, my name is Shloka. I'm from India. I'm with the Master's in Public Policy at the Kennedy School. Thank you very much for your speech today. I think what struck me most were your comments about the need for regional stability, and I think perhaps what threatens South Asian peace the most is the growing regional rivalry over its rivals. And I was wondering if you could talk a bit about what the US can do to ensure that this is an opportunity for cooperation rather than clashing. Because we have approximately 1.5 million people in the region that's growing at a rate of about 1.7% each year. So that's 25 million mouths to feed and provide water to.
Right. So you're talking about the water issue in general?
Water issue in general.
I think there are two ways that I know of to go about this. One is to work through multilateral institutions, and I'm not sure that the institutions are strong enough or binding enough to do that. One of the things that those of us who are used to who have worked in Europe is an overarching kind of exoskeleton of organizations like the OSCE, EU, et cetera, where you have mechanisms to deal with this. So one thing we may have to do is to create institutions that bring people together, either ad hoc or in other ways, or to use some existing institutions and strengthen them like SAR to see if those things can discuss these kinds of issues. But I think another way to look at it is that other countries can be supportive of the key countries. That is to say, if there are going to be discussions between India and Pakistan, I think people who are friendly to both countries can offer technical advice. People can offer encouragement and to see behind the scenes, because let's face it, a lot of times if America or others gets out in front, it looks like we're giving directions in a way we don't mean to do. So I'll give you an example. There's an excellent study produced by the Friends of Democratic Pakistan on water usage. And I think it would be a great topic of discussion by people in the region. We'd like to see that happen. But we want to see leadership from the countries in the region to do that. So it's a very delicate thing to talk about. It's important, but I think it's important that the impetus does come from the people who are most directly affected, not seem to be dictated
We have time for a few more questions. We're going to end the session at 5:30. I hate to do this to my good friend, but now that we're talking about regional cooperation, I wonder, Sean, Ambassador Sarin, you know, your thoughts on the trajectory of the India-Pakistan relationship. You're a veteran of many conversations between the two governments. Is there a reason to hope that the two countries, given the dialogue of the foreign secretaries and the ministers, might be able to make some progress on the issues that Ambassador wanted to talk about?
Thank you very much, and Ambassador, thank you very much for an excellent presentation. Well, even as we speak, we have the Indian Trade Minister visiting Pakistan with about 100 businessmen from India. And we do hope that the business and economic relationship will start evening some of the promise that obviously lies in the relationship. The formal trade between India and Pakistan is about $1.5 billion to $2 billion, but the informal trade, particularly trade through places like Dubai or through Kuwait, is multiples of that, about $4 billion, or in excess of $4 billion. So that just goes to show how much potential there is in the relationship. But as far as India-Pakistan relations are concerned, my own sense is that it is best to move incrementally. In both countries, there is sometimes a feeling that we should aim for this grand reconciliation between the two countries, you know, two estranged brothers coming together. I think that is the wrong way to go about the relationship. The narratives, historical narratives of the two countries are very different. The same events that have taken place in the last 60 years, the way Pakistan looks at those events and the way India looks at those events are completely poles apart. So it will be some time before we get to the point where we can really think in terms of reconciliation. But that does not mean that we don't have great opportunities for managing what is a very difficult relationship. Just as the United States has to manage a very difficult relationship with Pakistan. The good news is that through whatever has been happening over the last couple of years, frankly, one of the positive things I find is that India is not part of the controversy for the first time.
We're doing our best.
You're grateful for America.
So, you know, is that a step forward? Maybe. India is not on the in the sights as much as it usually is. And I think India has done a good thing to sort of stay a little away from the events that are taking place in Pakistan. We have tried very hard not to insert ourselves into that controversy. I think that is prudent on the part of India. But change, which will come, in my view, will come in principle. Whenever we have tried to go for the big prize, a lot of people in Pakistan and a lot of people perhaps in India too react to that very negatively, because a whole series of vested interests have grown up around that kind of a hostile relationship. And the prospect that they met, that might actually dissolve is something which is very unsettling to we would not certainly like to see them encouraged in any way. At a time where the relationship is slowly moving forwards, I don't know whether this will continue on the same trajectory. I mean, we have had such phases before, and we have had a Mumbai or a Delhi terrorist attack which sets us back. And I think there has to be a realization in Pakistan that Mumbai, for example, has been a very deep scar on the psyche of Indian public. So we have had a very large number of people in the past who were really very genuinely committed to India-Pakistan friendship. But after Mumbai, their voices have become muted. And I think we'll have a long way to go before we can overcome that. But yes, currently, I think the trajectory is very positive.
Thank you, Ambassador Sarin. Ambassador Sarin is speaking on Wednesday here. We hear it throughout the week with our students. Maybe two very quick questions, and we'll wrap up this conference.
Hello, my name is Runa, and I'm
see 2 months.
My question is that, so Secretary Clinton talks about smart power, Arun Jokhazanai talks about soft power. The American position has been more hard power, drone attacks, what word that you can't use. Where does, what is your view and the use of soft power? Because I'm hearing that between the lines, and I would like you to comment on that.
Yeah, the defense, America's defense, which is necessary, and which is the job of any diplomat overseas and any American institution, is going to continue. The fact is, though, that there is also a way to do diplomacy, and I hope that whether we call it smart or whether we call it soft power, that what I'm trying to intimate is that one of the directions that we would like to take to do that is to recognize that in Pakistan you have social structures and you have non-state strengths that we would be wise to work with. And we try to work with that. I mean, we talked a little bit about assistance and about democracy promotion. We could do much more. And we could do much more if we weren't focused entirely on state-to-state relations. That is, in getting strong institutions of society involved. It would be great. Now, if we are successful in our first task, which is a hard task, which is getting with the bad guys, something that we and the Pakistani people want to do, it will be much easier for us to have relations where citrus experts from Riverside, California can go to the Agricultural University in Faisalabad and work on new forms of kiwi, you know, this kind of thing. Right now, part of what limits business investment, there's not a lot of investment going in right now, is that people are scared. Part of it's also the fact that there are other impediments to business that we want to work with our Pakistani friends to try to fix. But if we are trying to, through our what we would call hard power, to what we call soft power, work together to get towards a greater cross-societal interaction, I think that's where the smartest results are going to come from. I mean, much as I love being a U.S. government civil servant, there are many things we can't do. And I think admitting that is probably the wise policy, and looking to other players to do it better than we do is something we have to do. Let me add one thing I didn't mention. There's a hugely dynamic Pakistani-American diaspora that is very successful, very interested in helping Pakistan. And this is a group that I think very much wants to play a role in the future of democratization and prosperity in Pakistan. We would be wise to be as active as we can to open doors between the Pakistani diaspora and Pakistan in a meaningful way. And that's what we'd like very much to do.
We have time for one last question. I apologize to everyone who wanted to ask a question and wasn't able to do that, but I'm sure Ambassador Munter will stay for a few minutes after this. Final question.
Mr. My name is Hanif Shella. I'm from Pakistan Civil Services and presently doing my master's here. I have just two quick questions. One of the issues with USAID projects is that they are very slow moving and suffer from lack of coordination. I worked with 5-6 different projects in Sindh and Balochistan. And my second question is, Pakistan is, you rightly mentioned, an energy starved country like other developed countries. Is there any U.S. plans for non-conventional assistance to Pakistan, like United States and India?
So the first answer, yes, the idea is slow. And it's a disappointment. Part of the reason the idea is slow is because the idea is very careful in having audits and being careful about how the money is spent. But it's still no excuse for the fact that the idea just moves too slowly. And much of the promise, this over-promising I was talking about, had to do with our expectations, many of us in the government. I wasn't there at the time, probably me, most of us in the government who thought that we were going to see that money from Kerry Lugar Berman flow a lot faster. And this got America the reputation of saying you all talk and no action. And the fact is, it was very slow. We now have a lot of the pipelines moving, but it took a long time. It'll be his job. On the question of, I think you used the word
non-conventional.
Are you talking about nuclear power?
Is there any
I don't see one
United States policy for nuclear assistance to Pakistan to overcome significant crisis like you did doing?
There are none, but what we have is
Jordan's white knight there. There's no civil nuclear deal for Pakistan of the type that Sean and I negotiated. Let me say.
What Nick means to say is that the Pakistani government the Pakistani parliament, the National Security Committee of the parliament, will be debating issues that are important to Pakistan in the U.S. relationship. This debate is scheduled to take place any day now, and we're waiting for it. We have been told by members of the committee that one of the issues they want to talk about is non-conventional energy. We are willing to talk with the Pakistani government, with our experts, about everything. But at this point, I mean, let's be real, this was not the Sibmel arrangement with India. It was a long and torturous road. And for any country to talk about this, you know, this takes a long time and there's got to be a lot of safeguards. So we want to talk about the broadest interpretation of how we can help solve the energy needs for Pakistan, whether it's regulatory change, whether it's pricing and kind of distorted tariffs, whether it's liquid natural gas, whether it's exploration. We want to do everything we can because we realize that is, when you talk to Pakistanis, that's one of the key things they want to see solved, and that's what we want to see solved. Because, as we say, strong Pakistan is a strong North. And on that note,
you can see why you